Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, I thank you for this time to gather together today, and we thank you that you love each and every one of us. Mm-hmm. Lord, right where we are right now, you're ready to touch us. So I pray now that you would use Pastor Izzy as a vessel to speak through this morning, that you would encourage your people. Help us hear your voice and choose to follow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone that agreed said,
amen. Amen. Well, Lord, we also pray that our sound system will record properly today. We've been having problems, and that fouls up the fellows that do the radio programming later. Oh, I forgot to share a praise report. On your bulletin, the very last announcement, we got news this week from Steve Hunter over in California. He's been trying to work with, we're on the radio. Calvary Chapel has a network of full-powered FM stations that go all the way up and down the west coast of the United States. So California, Oregon, Washington, they have these full-powered FM stations. And so we're on every week there, and I think our radio station is called Celebrate the Lord, and it has one of Steve's songs, that Beach Boy praise music, you know, for the intro. It's awesome. And so they just take our messages, what you guys hear here, they edit it to fit the radio slot and put it on the air, and they clean it up and take away all my stuttering and make me sound a lot better. So if you want to hear me polished up, just listen to that. But they also got this week word that will be on CSN. CSN has like 400 plus stations across the United States and through the islands here. So, well, you guys won't get to hear it because it's actually during our church service when it airs. It'll be during, so unless you have a way to record it or something, or you can listen to CSN on demand online at csn.com. So they have a website and all that. It's all linked on our website. So if you want to go look at it, or you want to tell a friend, you say, hey, I want you to hear, you know, the message, what we just listened to. The messages also here are being filmed and then put on YouTube. Our dear brother here, Dylan's been working really hard. And Dylan, I'm so proud of him. He starts school at the University of the Nations this month and Friday. And he's going for a video degree. I don't know what to call it. I'm calling it a video degree. Something in that arena, you know. They have an actual fully accredited school over there now for that discipline, and they put out some awesome work in their video production department. So I'm excited for him because he's going to continue to grow and learn, and we're going to continue to support him as he produces them. My daughter Joy and her husband Robbie have said they are helping tithe so that he will keep going to school and keep learning and keep making the videos, because my daughter says, Dad, you know, I hate to tell you this, but listening to you on the radio is okay, but you know, or on CSN, on iTunes, but she said, it's better when we see you, because you move around, and you move your hands, and she was spoiled. She grew up watching me her whole life, so she just, you know, in her mind, she would picture Dad up here doing, you know, preaching, and she said, but when we watch you on YouTube, it's so much better than just listening. So I feel really blessed that we can introduce people to hearing it on the radio, and then we can invite them to go over and check it out on YouTube and our YouTube thing. So if, for those that want to find the link, just go to AmazingGraceKona.com. And on the front of our website, there's links to the Facebook, there's links to the YouTube, and it'll take you right to. And you can see the message, and you can tell your friend. If you hear a message, you go, oh, man, I got one friend really needed that's what they were just asking me about. If you're not, maybe you're not really gifted at, you know, teaching it, but you're like, hey, come here, here's the link. Or you can email them the link and say, just listen, the pastor just went over this. Go to minute, and you can skip ahead, you know, like, you're like, it's about 10 minutes in. Just go 10 minutes forward, drag the thing, and listen to what he says. And that might be your part in the gospel of helping your friend's faith. It's just, the Bible says, how will they hear unless there's a what? A preacher. Someone has to tell the good news. That's what a preacher does. A preacher is a proclaimer of the good news. So I get the privilege of proclaiming to you really good news today, that Christ came to die for our sins. And that was his purpose. He said, I didn't come to condemn the world. I came to what? To save it. And today, we're going to pick up our study in the book of Romans. Now, Romans, Paul is writing to the church at Rome around 58 AD. This book is what I call Galatians on steroids. If you, those of you guys know in the Bible, the little epistle of Galatians, it's just a short little letter that Paul wrote to the church at Galatia. Now, the scholars debate. It's during his time of imprisonment. The problem is Paul was imprisoned multiple times for the gospel. So when they're trying to kind of nail down when did he write the book of Galatians, they say it's either in like 49 AD when he was in prison or in 53 to 55 AD. I mean, there's a lot of times he got thrown in jail for the gospel. So it's one of those times. Well, if you read the book of Galatians, it's kind of like taking the book of Romans and Spark Notes. You guys heard of Spark Notes? The kids do this when they have to do reports and they have to know what a novel is about. They don't read the novel. They go to the internet and they hit Spark Notes and say, what's it about? And they get a sum up, a Reader's Digest version. You know, for your older ones, you know, Reader's Digest, right? It's just summed up the story and tells you the main points. That's what Galatians is to the book of Romans. Galatians is like the sum up without a lot of all of the full details, just like the main points, the bullet points of it. But it was written, the book of Galatians was written by the same author, just to the churches in the region of Galatia. And when he was writing to them, it's interesting to me, he had to address the same, how do I say it, the same topic. Now, the book of Romans does a much more thorough job of covering this topic. And the topic that we're being introduced to right now, this is one of those topics that if you're going to have your faith be balanced, I mean, what I can, have any of you ever run into these wacko Christians? They're like nut jobs. I mean, I don't mean to, how many in trouble for saying this, but there are some people that their Christian experience is not really what we call an even keel. It's like they're like a sailboat without the little ballast that comes down in the bottom in the water to keep the boat from rocking too far. I mean, they're like sailing on the side, you know, and they're listing, and they're not really able to tack or jibe across the lake because they don't have the balance that Christ brings into their faith. And it's because they maybe, well, believe me, when I was doing the book of Revelations with the kids, we were doing chapter 2 of the book of Revelations, the very first letter Jesus sends to the church at Ephesus. He says, write to the angel of the church at Ephesus, write these things. And you did a good job, you're a nice church, you know, you guys test the people who say they're prophets, but they're false, you know, and you have good toils, you know, they were what we consider a church that was out there doing it. But they had been doing it for about 4 decades. When at the time when John the Apostle writes the book of Revelation, 96 AD, the church of Ephesus had been established 40 years prior. And it was established, I took the time to tell the kids the background. You can look on YouTube if you want to hear the whole background of that book because it's given to us in the Bible. I mean, we have so much information about the church of Ephesus that we don't about any of the other 7 churches of the 7 letters. But one of the cool things is you find out that the church of Ephesus was founded with a bunch of fellows that really, did they know everything? Did they have it all together? Did they understand all the things about God? No. They had one fellow who was preaching with real fire and real passion. I mean, but he was preaching the baptism of John. Remember John the Baptist said, repent, prepare ye the way of the Lord. You know, make ready. The Lord is coming is what he's saying. Get ready for the coming of the Lord. And so John preached a gospel message that was that very first word we're introduced to in the gospel, repentance. Turn away from your sin. Get yourself ready for the coming Savior. It's interesting that in Western Christianity, some people have actually told me, Pastor, don't start teaching people to repent. That's like, you know, you might step on someone's toes. You're like telling them, stop sinning, you know. That's a bad intro to getting them into the faith. I'm thinking, if it's a bad intro, how come it's the intro that God used? You know, how come it's the intro that You know, the first guy sent, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, as Isaiah declared, that this one, this prophetic one that would come before the Messiah, the forerunner to the Messiah, John the Baptist, he only had one message. I don't know if you ever studied that in the New Testament, but all the guy does is stand up and say, repent. Stop your sin. Get ready to meet the Lord. He's coming. And people say, but Pastor, when you preach that, you know, you're stepping on people's pet sins. I mean, that's their favorite thing to do. And you're making them uncomfortable. And you might make them squirm. And I'm like, dude, would you rather stop sinning and have the Lord show up? And you already stopped. Or have him show up while you're in the middle of doing it? I was raised a good Catholic boy. I always thought, please don't come while I'm doing it. You know? Be better if you could come. This is my Catholic upbringing, just a kind of carryover. But we used to go to confession on Saturday. And we go in this little box and we tell the priest what we did wrong. He'd give us the prayers that we are, how many Our Fathers, how many Hail Marys. And when we came out, we'd have to pray those prayers. And the next day before we took communion in the service, we had to kneel down and do our prayers of penance and get the, you know, we go up, we get the communion, we come and we kneel down, and we weren't allowed to sit back up in the pew until we were done praying how many prayers. And I only tell you this because I knew I was the most wicked person in the whole church. Because I never got up to the pew. They were all starting on with the service. I'm still on my knees going, Our Father, help me. You know, I was like, I'm thinking, I got the most Our Fathers, and I was speed praying. I mean, I could do Our Father, and amen, and start again. I still couldn't beat him. I was like, either I'm the most wicked guy in the whole room, or somebody else isn't doing their prayers right. You know? Or there's some secret way to do it faster that I don't know. And I only tell you this because it kind of got me this idea that I hope Jesus comes for the church. You know, we were taught that he would come again, but I hope he comes like on maybe between Saturday at confession and Sunday before the sermon is over, before we get to the parking lot. Because see, when you go to, to the Catholic church I went to, St. Teresa's, and you have a bunch of Italians, and they're all so nice inside. You know, peace of the Lord be with you. Peace of the Lord be with you. Peace of the Lord. You know, and they put the holy water on and sit down. And they do all these things that make you think, wow, so peaceful in here. But when you get to the parking lot afterwards in the service, the Italian side comes out. They start yelling, hey, get out of the way. We're trying to get out of here. We got to go to lunch, you know. And that low blood sugar, hangry thing, hungry, angry comes out. And old Christianity is gone out the window. I mean, the nice people in the church are not so nice now in the parking lot. I'm not going to talk, we haven't even got on the street. And people say to me, Pastor, you know there's a bunch of hypocrites at church. I'm like, yeah, I go, mm-hmm. You're right. Because our Christianity shouldn't stop the second we step away from service. Should be something we live the entire time. Now, here's this message that was preached to the church at Ephesus, and this fellow Apollos had gone in and started sharing it, but he didn't know the full story. And Paul, the apostle, had worked with a couple, Priscilla and Aquila, and they went in and they said, hey, that's a really good message you're preaching. John the Baptist was saying, get ready for the one that was coming after him. And he's like, yeah, yeah, but, and it, just to update you, news traveled not like it does today, you know. Something happens on the other side of the world, we know like in 2 seconds. Facebook alert, bleep, you know, there was a bombing over in Europe, right? I mean, it can happen, and within seconds, we're aware of it. But this fella did not know over in Ephesus that back in Jerusalem, the Messiah had already come. And they had already rejected him and killed him and crucified him, and he'd been laid in a tomb, and then 3 days later, upset everybody by rising from the dead. And saying, now, if you want to get to God, who do you have to go through? He said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. I'm the door, he said, to the sheepfold. You want to get in, you got to come through the door. And so some people get mad at me for telling this story. I'm like, I didn't say it. He said it. You mad at it? You don't like it? Take it up with Jesus. Seriously. Go yell at him. I don't like that you made your the only way. See how it works for you. I don't know. I mean, but he's the one who proclaimed it. So Priscilla and Aquila told Apollos about it. He went, oh, that's great. And then he turns around and starts proclaiming to everyone, hey, guys, listen to this. The Messiah has come. And from the scripture starts to bring great, powerful proofs about Jesus. And this church that had guys that didn't really know what they were doing. And when Paul shows up, he's like, so what'd you guys get baptized into? You know, like you have a club already going here. They said, into John's baptism. And he says, well, you need to be baptized into Christ. He said, have you guys received the Holy Spirit? They go, we don't even know if there is a Holy Spirit. Now, being raised Catholic, we knew about the Holy Spirit, right? Father, Son, and what's the last? Holy Ghost, right? Or Holy Spirit. Holy Ghost, same thing, you know. So I already knew about that, but they didn't. They didn't know. We had never heard of that. And so Paul prays with them. And it says there were in total, this is back up from the book of Revelation, 40 years, there was 12 fellas. 12 fellas that God used to start a push of spreading the gospel through all Asia Minor. With these 12 fellas who actually didn't really have it together. They didn't really know stuff, but does that stop God from working in our lives? We sang a song this morning, he who began a good work in you is faithful to what? To complete it. God is at work in every single one of us, it says in the book of Philippians, and we're just works in progress. If we would stay humble and acknowledge that, the stuff what we're going to look at in Romans makes so much more sense because it explains this whole idea of us being a work in progress, the progress that's happening. And some people, they progress in some areas really fast. You know, this is one thing I've become acutely aware of being a pastor for over 3 decades, is that some people, their progress is just, I mean, they're a quick study. They just seem to learn and gobble up the things of the Lord, and they grow. Just, it's like Miracle-Grow on them, you know? I mean, they're like plants with Miracle-Grow. They grow. But you have other plants that are like in a desert, and they're still there, but they're just barely alive. And you talk growth, and you're like, I don't see any. You know, it just looks like a dead stick. It's waiting for water. It needs a little more nourishment to cause the growth. And there are some Christians in that state, and you don't see them grow much. And we need a reminder of the truth, what Paul is starting to, he's elaborately going to explain this truth, and the truth he's going to bring out, he's writing to the church at Rome. I got a question for you. Those of you that studied history, in the times of Christ, when was Rome known to anyone around the world? Were they? Yeah, they were if you don't know this, they were the world dominant force in the days that Christ came to this earth. 2,000 years ago, Rome was ruling what we consider the whole known world. They were in charge. When you're in charge with that type of power, did they have any educated folks? Sure. They were known for being the center of knowledge. Now, they had conquered the Greeks who previously had ruled the world. But Rome takes the power wand away from the Greeks and takes over. And they take that learning, what the Greeks had. They had a lot of philosophers. But when Rome took over, they captured those guys and drug them off to Rome. And they put them in their institutes of learning and said, all right, let's see what you know, and let's find out if does that fit with everything else. And there was a compounding of knowledge. These fellows, you know, some of the stuff was discovered in the days of Jesus by the Roman Empire. Things in architecture, in physics, in building. Do you know that some of those things that they discovered, we still use today in building? Some of the very, you know, devices that were engineered. We just maybe refined how they look or something. But the actual patent, I'll just use that. There wasn't a patent back then, but the idea, it was back, you know, Da Vinci was making stuff. Those guys were, you know, creating stuff, and we use that stuff. They weren't stupid. And yet they didn't understand some of the basic things about God. And they had been hit with a whole bunch of, I mean, the Greeks who ruled before as a world-ruling empire, they were polytheistic. They had all sorts of different gods. You know, you've studied Greek culture, right? You've got Hermes and Zeus and Aphrodite and all these different gods and goddesses competing and a power struggle between them. And the Romans, they're like, hey, we're God. I mean, they kind of acted like they were. We're in charge. And there was a lot of man worship if you study the Roman teachings, that they didn't really want to look outside. But Paul has to come along and write to this church and appeal to them. And I see this more as an intellectual appeal. He's writing to educated guys. He's not like dumbing this down. He's going to explain a truth, a spiritual truth, but this is one of those ones you don't turn your brain off to get it. It's one of those ones, you know, for those of you who have educated loved ones who say, I don't know about Christianity, they're all so simple-minded, they're, you know, they don't seem to know anything, higher learning, they ignore that. No. The Bible tells us that Paul was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was educated under Gamaliel, one of the chief, I mean, most respected rabbis in all of Israel, and not just Israel, of all that whole region of the Mediterranean. They said, that guy Gamaliel, he's one of the most brightest minds of the day. He's like the Albert Einstein. And this is who Paul studied under. So when Paul goes to make a point to these educated guys, his point is going to be delivered. How do I say? When he wrote to the church at Galatia, it was more like, here's the main point, bullet note, you know, Spartan notes, Reader's Digest, all summed up. When he writes to these guys, he goes, I got a point to make. But it's kind of like the difference between a first-year college student writing a paper. That's Galatians. You know, I got a little bit of understanding. I wrote the paper, right? By the time that he writes the book of Romans in 58 A.D., Paul is more like a doctorate student who's got, you know, he's doing his thesis. He's got all of his notes backing him up. He's got all of the things, your references, you know, you got to have them all typed out and everything. He's like ready to put all the references on the table and say, this is why this is true. Now, he said the truth already years before, but in a much more summed up way. Let me show you what truth I'm alluding to this morning. In Romans chapter 3, he had already said, what advantage is there to being a Jew? If God will accept a man who's not a Jew, who just lives by his own conviction, the things that the law teaches, even though he doesn't know the law, he doesn't have the law, he's a law unto himself. He's just by nature doing the right thing. If you do the right thing, does God accept it? Or do you have to be Jewish and do the right thing? See, the scripture is very clear. It's not based on you must be Jewish and do the right thing. You must have the law and be follower of the 613 Levitical statutes, and then you're accepted. No. If you do, by nature, the things of the law, God goes, that's acceptable. He's looking, what we saw last week, where does God look at? The outward or the inward? The inward, right? He's interested in the heart. And so Paul, he's writing to these guys and he says, guys, listen. Though, he says, if somebody doesn't believe, does their unbelief negate God's faithfulness? Does that turn off God? Just because they say, well, I don't believe it. So I don't believe there's God. Does that make him disappear? No. I used that example of when I went to the circus and I saw that little stool that they balanced all these people on. And then afterwards they brought out an elephant and they put the elephant with one leg on this stool. And I thought, it's not going to hold. It looks so flimsy to my eye. I mean, it looked like a couple tubes, you know. And I don't know. Even to this day, I want to, when I get to heaven, I'm like, can I go back and see, what did they make that stool out of? Because it looked really light. Maybe it's titanium, and we just didn't know what titanium was back then. You know, because these guys had this little stool, and they stacked, like, I mean, clowns and a whole bunch of people on it. And it was like, you know, 30, 50 people up in the air, all balanced on this little round stool. Then they bring out an elephant. Well, first, the I don't know what the guy's called, the conductor of the thing or whatever. The ringleader. Yeah, the ringleader. Ringmaster. He's out there going, how many people do you think we can fit on this stool? How much weight do you think it can hold, you know? And you're looking at the thing, you're thinking, he's picking it up and spinning it around, and it looked like it was just like a feather. It's like a little stool you put your feet on. It's a little round thing. And he flips it around, he sets it on the ground, and he starts bringing out these folks and the acrobats and the clowns, and they start stacking on it and getting on each other's shoulders. And pretty soon, there's just like this pyramid of people, upside-down pyramid, stacked onto this little teeny stool. And I'm, as a little kid, I'm like waiting for it to break. I mean, come on, man. One more person is going to snap. They're all going to come down. And it looks like, for sure, it's going to be curtains. But then they bring out this elephant. They have all the people get down. The elephant puts one foot on it, and then he goes like this. And he lifts his back foot, and then he puts his other one out like that. And then, I can't do this, but he's like on one leg. The elephant's like this. And then guys start climbing up on the elephant's head. And then along the back. And then they start lifting each other. And they put all the same people who were just on the stool, now on the elephant, what is on the stool, all balanced. You know, this is a big, it's a part of the show, you know. Barman, Bailey, Ringling, brothers. I was wondering, do you think that they could, maybe I could find this on YouTube today? Because the kids today, they're like, YouTube everything, you know. Oh, let me see if the, I wonder if that's still around. I wonder if anyone ever filmed that. Because this is from going way back. This is when I was little. I don't want to tell you my age, but it was a long time ago. And I think that impressed me so much. And the ringmaster, after everyone left, he said, do you think that this stool will hold me now? You know, my weight. And it was such a silly question. I'm like, dude, it just held an elephant and like a whole, like, 30, 50 people on top of the elephant, and it didn't snap then. Of course it's going to hold your weight. That's like a ridiculous question to ask, you know? And I'm thinking, why is he asking this question? That stool is proven. I mean, that thing can hold weight. And I started thinking, when I was preparing this study, I was thinking, it says, if some would not believe, will it negate God's faithfulness? Like, if you said, maybe you come to the circus late and you didn't see the whole act with everybody and the elephant and the thing, and you come out right when the guy is ready to just say, so will this hold my weight? His little stool. And he was kind of a big guy, the ringmaster. If he went to sit, someone new might say, I don't know if you should sit on that. It looks kind of flimsy. But if you would have asked anyone in the audience who had seen the act before, what just took place, if you ask them, will that stool hold that one dude? They'll be going, are you kidding? Of course it'll hold him. Hold an elephant with a whole bunch of people. It's going to hold one person. The reliability of the stool in the people who have already seen what it can do, it's established in their minds. They know. But if some person comes into the tent and says, I don't think it's going to work, does their unbelief make the stool weak? Does their unbelief make it not work? This is the intro to Paul's argument. Because some people don't believe there's a God. Does that make God disappear? Does it make him not work? He's not reliable. You can't put your trust in him. You can't rest your weight on his shoulder. What, he can't hold you? I mean, those of you that have been a Christian long enough, you know, can God hold you? Can he carry you through those hard times? Amen, right? But to somebody who doesn't know it, they might think, I don't know. I'm not sure if he's strong enough. I'm not sure if he's able. And Paul is trying to establish a truth here. Just because some don't believe, their unbelief, does it make God unreliable? Does it make God unfaithful? Just because they don't see it, does that make God disappear? No. And this is really important because this is the intro to what he's about to teach. He's about to teach something that is actually fundamentally foundational for all Christians to understand. And by the way, if they did, we'd probably have less hypocrites. So I want to emphasize, this is a really important thing we take to heart, that we absorb what he's going to go over, because he's about to teach something that, I mean, honestly, it should be like put into a booklet as Christianity 101, mandatory, must learn this before you get to go to the next class. This is how important I think this truth is, what he's about to teach. Let me show you what he's going to teach. Now, he's going to do it so eloquently with all of the notes and quotes and references to passages from all over the scriptures. Okay, but let me show you the truth he's going to present. He says here, if their unbelief, it's not going to nullify the faithfulness of God, will it? Verse 4, he says, may it never be. Rather, let God be found true and every man be found a what?
A liar.
He says, as it is written, you that you may be justified in your words, and you will be blameless when you judge. And we studied that in depth last week. If you want to check that out on YouTube now, you can see that whole background to that story was when David sinned and how God was faithful, and David was the one that was in sin. He says in verse 5, but if our unrighteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say then? You know, if we do unrighteousness and God still does righteousness, what is it saying? He's got a point to make here. He says, what shall we say? The God who inflicts wrath is not unrighteous, is he? You know, is God unrighteous because he inflicts wrath on people who do wrong? Is it allowed for the creator of the universe to make a judgment on, hey guys, I'm telling you the way of life, you know, whatever you sow, that you will what? Reap, right? If you sow good things, you're going to reap these good things. You sow bad things, well, yeah, you're going to reap bad things. I mean, if you sow to yourself in sin, it says you reap in death. And some people, they get all uptight with me when I tell them don't sin. But the Bible teaches us to break off our sin, to repent, turn away from our sin. Repent, by the way, means do a 180-degree turn. If you're walking in a direction towards sin and you are truly repentant, that means you now turned your way from going straight toward the sin to going straight what? Away. It's like a skateboarder understands. Do a 180. So when you're skating one direction, you flip the board around, you're going the opposite. If you're skating in the path going towards sin, the Bible wants to tell you, turn around, go the other way, go away from it. And God is, he's righteous. He's allowed to judge. When we're doing what's wrong, he's still God. He can't be unfaithful to who he is. Okay, this is Paul's making this point. Now he says, I'm speaking in human terms, but I'm trying to let you understand. May it never be, verse 6, for otherwise how will God judge the world? And he says, but if through my lie the truth of God abounded to his glory, why am I still being judged as a sinner? Now Paul, we get a little insight here. Paul is getting some heat that he is being judged as a sinner. Who are you, preacher? You know, you're just a stinking sinner. By the way, when people say that about me, I'm like, got me. In fact, Paul will say he is the chiefest amongst the sinners. He never said, no, I am perfect. I don't sin. Of course, no wonder people think there's hypocrites in the church, because the church acts like, well, we're not sinners. Let me tell you the truth that Paul's trying to introduce here. And you tell me if this is important. He says here, verse 8, why not say, as some slanderously reported, and some claim that we say, let us do evil, that good may come. Someone was slandering Paul and saying, he says just do evil so good will come to cover up the evil. If those of you that are students of the book of Romans know, by chapter 6, he says, what shall we say then? Should we continue to sin that grace might abound? What was the answer? God forbid it. May it never be. Their condemnation is just. What then? Are we better than they? Now pay attention. This is important. Are we better than they? Not at all. You might want to highlight verse 9. We are not better than anyone. He says, "For we have already charged that both Jews and Greeks are all under sin, as it is written." Now, here's his notes. Here's his references for his doctoral thesis. He starts off by quoting the Psalms. He says, "There, as is written, there is none righteous, not even one." Foundational truth that you need to make a note to. How many righteous people are there down here? None. The Bible teaches there's only one that fulfilled the law fully in righteousness. And who was that? God's Son. I mean, as far as the rest of us, there's not even one of us that is righteous, perfect, without sin. There is none, it says, who understands. There is none, it says, who seek after God. All have turned aside together and become useless. There's none who does good. In the Hebrew, this means who does good. It's in the tense present continuous. Who does good continually. Always. Always doing good. There's nobody who is always doing good. There is not even one. Now, just to let you know, he's quoting from Psalm 14, the first three verses, which Psalm 14 has a sister psalm, Psalm 53. If you want to do a little extra credit, you just for fun, read the two psalms side by side. See if you notice anything about them. You might pick up on it. But he's picking pretty credible parts to back his doctoral thesis. He doesn't just pick one passage. He picks the passage that in the book of Psalms, by the way, I'll give it away for you. Psalm 14 and Psalm 53 are identical. In there is one line in the Hebrew in Psalm 53. It's actually, we break it down differently. We break the first three passages or lines in Hebrew into three verses in Psalm 14, and we make it four verses in Psalm 53. But if you read the words, they're the same. The idea is exactly the same. The psalm is repeated. Now, is that a typo? You know, the Bible actually repeats a psalm twice. Whole thing. Not just the first three verses, by the way. The whole psalm, you can read it, is repeated. Why would God put the same words in twice? I was always taught when a teacher revisits the truth, you know, like hits it and then later hits it again, I'm supposed to be paying attention. And maybe I didn't get it on one of the passes, so they repeat it, so I'll get it on the second pass, right? I mean, it's for emphasis. And the very thing he leads with is, how many of us are righteous? According to the Psalms, not one. He says, verse 13, their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they keep deceiving. The poison of asps is on their lips. Oh, that's a polite comment. How good is their speech? It's like the poison of the most deadly snake is on their lips. Oh, that's just sweet, you know. Give me a kiss, right? I mean, the kiss of death. I mean, this is what's coming out of their mouth. But he's quoting from another psalm. By the way, this next verse, verse 13, is actually two verses from Psalm 5, 9, and Psalm 1, 4. I'm not going to turn to, I was going to take you to all those psalms and, like, give you the whole entirety, because it's even sweeter when you, like, Paul knew the whole psalms and the background to them, and he picked some really key verses here. But if you're a student of Scripture, you know, and you get just the main bullet points of the psalms, of those fancy psalms, your brain will go, yeah, heard that one in Shabbat school. Or in Sunday school. Yeah, that was one they went over a bunch of times. Yeah. So he's actually doing what we would call recalling highlight verses that the Jews knew. They were taught in their schools. They would go, yeah, we know that. But isn't it interesting how sometimes there's a big gap between what we know, what we've heard, and it's passed into the ear, but sometimes the registration between these two ears, it goes in and it kind of like one of those pinball machines, bing, 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 bing. But it never lands in the socket where we actually, ding, light goes on, we get it. So what Paul is doing is he's picking the really, these are like, if you were in Jewish culture, you would have learned these psalms. And he's picking like the most common ones that are the highlight versions. And he's starting to put them, hoping that, you know, oh, yeah, I know that psalm. Oh, that's the one where it talks about he sinned and then, you know, had to cry to God for forgiveness. And, oh, yeah, psalm. And he's starting to do this, collecting them and putting them back to back. Psalm 5:9, Psalm 140, verse 3. Verse 14, Psalm 10, verse 7. He says, whose mouth are full of cursings and bitterness. Then the next one, verse 15, their feet are swift to shed blood. That's a verse from Isaiah. Paul isn't limited to the Psalms. He hits all the highlights. That's Isaiah 59, verse 7. Then destruction and misery are in their path. The path of peace they have not known. There's no fear of God before their eyes. Psalm 36, verse 1. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. The law is speaking to the whole world. And it's going to close our mouths to this one fact. You look at verse 20. It says, because by the works of the law, how many people will be justified in God's sight by doing the law? Those Old Testament commandments in Exodus 20, the Ten Commandments that were given, they broke down into the 613 Leviticus. How many of us would be justified with God if we tried to follow the Ten Commandments? I don't know about you, but I learned the Ten Commandments at Catholic school. I didn't even make it through the first couple, and I had already broke them. And I was just a little wee one. I'm pretty sure if we did the whole list, we'd all get busted at least in one or two points. Some of us, we're lucky if we have one or two we didn't break, you know. But the reality is, the law is there pointing out there's not one of us that's righteous. You know, when you read the rules, you're like, busted. You know, did that one. Not supposed to. Yep, I did it. Well, through the law comes the knowledge that I'm not just. And listen to what he says. This is really important. Because some people today, you might run into some Christians today. They say, well, we're Christians, but we're trying to adopt a kind of a Judaism approach to our Christianity. So we're Christians, but we follow the law. And so we don't eat pork, because that's in the Levitical statutes that they're not allowed to eat the unclean meat. And we don't have lobster. We don't have, you know, any of these unclean shellfish, or we don't. And they call themselves Christians, but they're Christians that have adopted the Jewish law as we're gonna live under the law. And Paul had just got done saying, how much flesh is justified by the law? How many people got justified by following the law? You need to pay attention, because I can't build the rest of the book of Romans until you get this answer down. How many? For the guys on the camera, zero. None. There is nobody that has fulfilled the law that can say, except one. Jesus. He's the only one that could. He said, I didn't come to abolish the law. I came to what? Fulfill it. See, there was a requirement in the law that there would have to be a perfect lamb that would be offered as a sacrifice for the sins of the imperfect. And Jesus said, I didn't come to get rid of the law. I came to fulfill it. And remember John the Baptist, the guy we were talking about earlier, the one who said, repent? Does anyone remember the other line that he preached all the time? When he was in public, there was Jesus walking by. As soon as he sees Jesus, he says, behold the what of God? The Lamb of God who what? Takes away sins of the world. That's the guy who takes away That's the guy coming to fulfill the law. You needed a perfect, blameless lamb. A sinless one to die for the sinner. The sinner couldn't do it for himself. You had to have the perfect sacrifice to pay for our sin. That's the glorious news of the gospel. So how many of us are righteous according to the law? None. Okay, just to finish up, it's easy to do. This is like what I call the quick sum up. Turn to Galatians. I want to show you. All this, what Paul took all these quoting of Psalms to say, he doesn't quote the Psalms. When he's writing to the church at Galatia, he just does this. He says in verse 22, chapter 3. I'm getting tired. I'm almost done, though. Galatians 3:22, he says, the scripture has shut up everyone under sin. I mean, if you think you're perfect, just read the rules and you'll find out you broke it somewhere. Okay? You failed. So the scripture basically has put a cork in all our mouths. None of us can say we're perfect. Now, what if the people in the churches actually said we're not perfect? I mean, how many objections have you heard from people saying, oh, those hypocrites, they live like they're perfect. But what if we said, no, we're not perfect. We just serve a guy who paid for our imperfection. And for him, we're very grateful because we're not perfect. That's what we should be telling people, not acting like we're perfect. The scripture shut up everyone under sin so that it says the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. But before faith came, we were kept in custody, it says, under the law, being shut up to a faith which was later to be revealed. Therefore, what's the reason for the law? He says the law is our tutor. Our tutor. To lead us to Christ so that we may be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we're no longer under the tutor. See, a tutor has a job of teaching you a lesson. Once the tutor teaches you the lesson and you get it, do you need the tutor? I mean, I kind of struggle to pick a good analogy for this. If I said, okay, the point is we're trying to get you to Jesus, right? And we need sometimes a little direction in our lives to get us to him. Maybe someone doesn't know the way. So God puts different... It'd be like if someone said to me, they come to visit our island, and they say, I use this example because I love... When we first moved here, they had only in one place, Javi. They had Tropical Dreams ice cream. I don't know if you guys ever had Tropical Dreams ice cream, but the coconut sorbet... And that macadamia nut one, and I got to stop talking now because my mouth is watering. It's lunchtime, but you know, just I'm hot and ice cream. That sounds so good. And when they say, "How do I get there?" That you talk about that ice cream, it sounds heavenly. I want to go there. I'd be like, "Well, you got to follow the signs that lead you right to the which side of the island, the south or the north, is Javi." So the north, the far north. So you want to get on the Highway 19, we call it the Queen Highway, the Belt Highway, and you want to go north, all the way to the north end of the island. It's just a little teeny hole in the wall. Now, if you haven't been there, it helps to have some pretty good directions because you can drive right past it and not see it. I mean, it's just tucked in a little teeny. And years ago, it was even harder to find than it is today. They have more signage now, but back then, you had to know where to go. And... They didn't really put out too much sandwich board signs. They relied on their reputation. You know, people wanted to go eat it because they heard it was so good. So it was word of mouth. And you had to rely on others to tell you the way. You had to rely on them to, you know, point out what to look for. What side of the road is it on? Is it on mountainside or on the ocean side? Malka or Makai, which side of the road was it on? How far, you know, as you're going north, do you go around the horn and start heading back down south, and then you spot it? You know, and you need somebody to give you instruction. Now, the instruction, if I said, okay, listen, I got some signs. This is, by the way, this is before they had Google Maps. That would have been really handy back then. But we had to find the thing by having someone give us some instructions. And we had to read the signs along the way. They were like our tutor pointing out the way. Now, you need the tutor to get you there if you've never been there. But what if you've been there and then you've gone back and you've got addicted and you go back a few more times and you've gone over and over and over and you know where it is? I mean, not only do you know where it is, you can lead your friends there, you know? And you can even give them good instructions better than you got to get them there. And you got it down. My question to you is, do you need the instructions that you first got? No. Why? Because you know the way. You know where the destination is. You've already been there. You've already arrived at the destination. You've partook of the thing. You don't need someone to teach you to get to that destination because you've already been there. And the law, spiritually, is like road signs and directions to point us to the Messiah. It's our tutor to lead us to Christ. But once you come to Christ, once you're sitting in his ice cream parlor, once you're there with the Creator, do you need the road signs that are out along the path anymore? No. They did their job. Does it make the road sign bad? No, it can still sit there and still point others. It still does its job. But am I now under the law that I go back to follow the road signs? I don't need to. I've already found that paradise. I already found that little slice of heaven. I got already the way to him. I found him. So when people say, what's the purpose of the law? To get us to him. Once you get to him, you don't have to go back to use the signs because you're already where you need to be, spiritually. And this is really important because we're seeing in Western Christianity a creeping in of some false teachers saying, we need to go back and follow the signs. And I'm like, why? Did you lose Jesus? If they did, they need to go back. Okay? But how many of you believe in Jesus? Raise your hand. You don't need the law anymore. It's already done its job. It's taught us. How many of us are not righteous? Not one of us. Do we all need the Messiah? It's done its job. It has schooled us properly. But why don't we act like that when we're out there with other people? We're just sinners that found out about a Savior. We're not better than anyone else. We're just grateful sinners that have found the one who saved us. And when we keep it in that perspective, we become more approachable. But, those people that feel those hypocrites, I understand why they feel like I felt like that. Anyone else felt like that in your past where you ran into those hypocritical Christians? Well, we're perfect, man. We don't have any problems. I'm like, when people come here and they go, we're perfect, you might want to leave. You're probably not going to fit in. It's not really, this is the group of the perfect. This is not the gathering of the perfect. It's the ones who have gathered because we found out that he's perfect. And we want to seek him. And we need his help. He's called the great physician. Anyone need the doctor to take care of you? The great physician? See, I do. Constantly I need his touch, his doctoring in my life. And I don't mind sharing that with people because I think it makes Christ a lot more approachable to the others that need his touch too. When you find a good doctor and they take good care of you, isn't it interesting how a good doctor really doesn't have to advertise? He's really good at his trade. People know. Oh, you're going to have surgery? Oh, don't go to those other guys. We heard terrible. Go to this guy. If the guy is really skilled at his craft, you find him out. And you want the guy who has the skill. And there are people hurting in this world right now. And all we have to do is say, we found the great physician, the greatest one, the one doctors my soul. When I've blown it, when I've made mistakes, when I've struggled, and still, even in the things where I'm still a work in progress, does he ever leave us or forsake us? Now, this is the foundation. It's really important you understand. Not one of us is righteous. I can't build the rest of the book of Romans unless we all agree this is the laid out foundation that we're building on. We're all just sinners. And he's the one that saves us. And if you start with that, the rest of the book of Romans, oh man, we're going to be building a palace for your faith. That stuff that can help your faith through the hardest of days comes what Paul brings. But see, Paul is one of those guys always, this is true, and since this is true, therefore, we can build upon that. And this is the part what he's smoothing out the concrete for the foundation. He's getting it ready and saying, we're getting ready to build. Ready to build? How many of us are sinners? All. Next week we'll see it in verse 23 of this chapter. All of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. If you have anyone who struggles with that, bring them next week. Okay? It's a really, maybe they just need to hear a preacher actually say it, that we're just all sinners. And you know what? I'll do it. Because it's right in the book. It's in the good book. And we're just all sinners. But we got a really good Savior, don't we? And that's what we want to point people to. So let's pray. Lord, thanks so much for this wonderful portion of Scripture that we have to look at. I pray, Lord, that you would make everything to have worked together to your glory this morning. All the kinks that we've had in our recording system be ironed out and it come clear, that we could share this message with others that will listen later. And Father, I'm so grateful for this body of believers that you've brought together, Lord. We just all are grateful for your Son, for his being that perfect lamb to die as a sacrifice for our sins. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying for us. Thank you for your forgiveness. And we just give you praise for that as we go from here, Lord. Strengthen our faith. Help us to be a light to those who have run into the hypocrites, that we could be a light of your grace and your mercy. And I ask that as we go from here now in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me, let's sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.